I will prepare the other wood and lay it on the wood and put no fire unto it. And you call upon the name of your God, small g, they are. And I will call upon the name of the Lord, and the God who answers by fire, he is God. So there was a challenge between Ahab's prophets and Jezebel's prophets. Ahab was the king then. And because the people were so confused whether to worship Baal or to worship the Lord, and so there's a showdown between Elijah and the 450 prophets of Baal, that whoever answers the Lord by fire, he is God. And the thing is, there will be two bulls to offer. One for the 450 prophets of Baal, the false prophets, and one for Elijah, the true prophet of God. And they had to cut each bone into pieces and put it on the woods, and then pray to whoever God you are praying for, and if that God will answer your prayer by consuming the meat of the bull with fire, then that is the true God. And you know what happened? The showdown started. The 450 prophets or false prophets were praying hard. They started in the morning, and until noon time, they were not even answered. Okay? And then Elijah was mocking their God and saying that perhaps you're not praying enough. That's why your God is answering you. Or perhaps your God is meditating. Or perhaps your God is resting. Or perhaps your God is relieving himself and taking a break, or on a long journey, or maybe your God is sleeping. Why don't you pray harder? And so what the prophets did was they cut themselves and blood gushed out, thinking and hoping that their God would answer. But as we know the story, no one answered. No fire came down from heaven to consume the offering. Now here comes the turn of Elijah to prove that the God who answers by fire is the true God, and rearranged the altar and the woods, and he took 12 stones to make for him as an altar representing the 12 tribes of Israel, and then cut the wood into pieces and put it on top of the woods. And what is more, he said, and he made a trench or a little canal around the altar. And then he asked the people to take jars of water and pour it on the meat, on the cut bulls and the wood. They did it first time. Do it again, get another jar and pour it. And then for the third time, and do it again for the third time. So in other words, really so wet. It's really so flooded. In their eyes, how can that be consumed with fire? It's so flooded with those things. And Elijah started to pray that, you know, to consume the fire. And suddenly, fire came down from heaven and consumed the meat, consumed the wood, and the people will revive. And this was his prayer. O Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known to this day that you are God in Israel, and that I am your servant, and that I have done all these things at your word. Answer me, O Lord, answer me, that these people may know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you have turned their hearts back. Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt offerings, and the wood, and the stones, and the dust that licked up the waters that was in the trench. And when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and said, the Lord is God. The Lord, he is God. So talking about these three mountains, Mount Moriah, Mount Sinai, and Mount Carmel. So three mountains in the Old Testament. Testament. How are we correlating this to the Mount of Mountain in the Old, in the New Testament? In our times, because we are part of the New Testament, then we go to the fourth mountain. Mount Calvary. Mount Calvary. It is the site where God's plan of salvation was fulfilled. Mind you, we are not talking only of salvation like going to heaven when you die. It's a full package when we talk about God's plan for man's salvation. So Mount Calvary is also called Golgotha in Aramaic. So that's another term for another word, a name for Calvary, Golgotha. It means in English, place of the skull. Not skull, place of the skull. And it is the mountain where Jesus was crucified. And it's the mountain where criminals are crucified, killed, humiliated. And it's the place of the skull. And it's not a pleasant place. It is not a place like Mount Moriah where there are so many trees. It's not a place like Mount Sinai where you can go up and meet the Lord up there. It's not a place like Mount Carmel where you can see God's power being manifested. But it's just a place of skull. A place of skull, very ugly. It's not recommendable for tourists to go there during those times because they would see death. They would not see anything. And that was where Jesus was crucified. Now the question was, why Golgotha? Why Calvary, an ugly place? Place for criminals. We know that Jesus doesn't deserve to die as a criminal. He was crucified at the cross, not because of his fault, not because he has many sins, he has no sin at all, not because he is a bad guy, not because he's a liar, but simply he is the Son of God, the Son of Man, our Savior, and our Redeemer. You know what? When I was studying this, my question was, why did he die in Golgotha or in Mount Calvary? It's a very unpleasant place. And you know the Lord has given me a revelation that Calvary represents us sinners. We are ugly in the sight of God because of sins. Calvary is ugly in the sight of people because it's a place of death. Criminals are being crucified there. Jesus wasn't a criminal at all, but then he was crucified there. Calvary has so meanings for us and for God. Although it could not be a very pleasant place for God, for the Father, but he appointed that place that Jesus would be dying in Golgotha or in Calvary, because that place is representing us so ugly, stained with sin, stained with crimes, and that's just how we are in the sight of God, that God, through his Son, paid the penalty of our sins so that he could look us up as beautiful people, not the ugliness of Golgotha, but because of what Jesus has done at the cross, is there is a personal relationship. And because of Mount Calvary, that is the place where God's plan of salvation is going to happen, going to be fulfilled and be completed, and no one else can defeat what happened or the incident that took place in Mount Calvary or in Golgotha, because that was where, in Mount Calvary, everything changed. Speaking of God and people. You know why? Because Mount Calvary is a for his own son instead of Isaac, for his own son Jesus, or the ram that took the place of Isaac in the Old Testament, Jesus was caught in a thicket, and that's why he was crucified, and that's where forgiveness was given to us, forgiveness for our sins, blessings, healing, mending broken relationship, answered prayer. It's all because of what happened in Mount Calvary. I'm not idolizing Mount Calvary. That's where the place where God appointed. And I'm just idolizing what Jesus and what the Father has done. The incident that happened in Mount Calvary. Mount Calvary is not only our Mount Moriah, but Mount Calvary is also our Mount Sinai. Mount Calvary is our Mount Sinai where God's presence was manifested. Remember I told you a while ago that in Mount Sinai, they were so eager to have a personal, to see the presence of God. They only felt through thunders and lightnings and thick clouds, and how would see God if the mountain was covered with all the clouds that they had? But in Mount Calvary, we saw God spiritually. We saw God with our spiritual eyes. We saw God with our heart. We don't need to see Him face to face at this time unless we die. We don't see Him face to face, but we could feel His presence when we are in need, because Mount Calvary is the place where God's presence was manifested. It started all up there in Mount Calvary. So Mount Calvary is not only Mount Moriah of our life. It's not only Mount Sinai of our Christian life. But Mount Calvary is also our Mount Carmel, where God's power was displayed. Do you remember what I told you about Mount Carmel, where the 450 fake prophets were defeated by a single prophet, Elijah? And you know why? In Mount Calvary, there was one fake prophet that was defeated, and that was Satan, representing the 450 fake prophets in the Old Testament. In Mount Calvary, there was one prophet who won, Elijah. And that is representing Jesus, the great prophet, who won over the fake prophet, Satan. And so it's... I could not contain it. I don't know if I will feel crying or whatever, because the amazing things that God has done in Mount Calvary, it is a very old place, sickening place, a place of death, and yet there was a source of life that happened there. There was a source of blessing that took place there. And Mount Carmel displayed the power of God over sin. We are the Calvary, the sin, the dirt, the sin, and you know, the other place. And yet, God look at us as precious children of God. Amen. Not because of what we did, but because of the one who was hanged at the cross in Calvary. So today, I'd like you to think, there's only still so many mountains, but I think only these three significant ones. To show us the goodness of the Lord, that because of His love for us, then He has given His Son for our sake.
Yeah.
He has given a Son to have power, so that we'll have power. We have power over sickness.
Yeah.
We have power over death.
Yeah.
We have power over all these things, because this power all came from Jesus, and this power have been dedicated to each and every one of us. And so when you receive the Lord, those power have been given to each and every one of you. Now, you would say that, how come I am not experiencing or feeling that power? Because it's your fault. It's our fault, not God's fault. Because you are not living in the fullness of God. Because you are not recognizing that God is a God of power, God of blessing, God of answered prayer, He's a God of this, He's a God of that, He's a total package God. You don't recognize this. Maybe you can just say that Jesus is my Lord and my Savior. That's it. But you do not recognize His power. You do not recognize the things that He has done in those mountains. So today, I'd like to challenge you to one. Come think of Mount Calvary, Golgotha. It surpasses all the beautiful mountains in the Old Testament. It's a lovely mountain. But then God used that to symbolize our dirty life. So let's all stand. Thank you.